at it. Wow, yeah, this is the Hennessey Venom F5, a new all-American hypercar, and it's loud as f***. Making all that noise is a 6.6 litre twin-turbo V8 called Fury, producing over 1,800 horsepower and almost 1,200 pounds-feet of torque, making it, for now at least, the most powerful production car engine in the world. The F5 name is derived from the Fujita Tornado Intensity Scale, F5 being the most intense, with wind speeds of up to 318 miles an hour, which is fitting, because the target top speed of this thing is over 311 miles an hour, or 500 kilometers an hour if you prefer, meaning it's also the fastest road car ever in waiting. Look, it's a lot to take in, so we thought we'd take a step back and throw it over to the big boss himself, John Hennessey, who's down at his very own drag strip to give us a bit of background on the cars that paved the way for this thing here.
Hey Jack, thank you very much. I wish I could be with you right now with the Venom F5 over there in the UK, but for obvious reasons I can't. So again, I just want to thank you for this opportunity and thank the viewers for their interest in the work that we've done over the last 30 years. As you guys may know, one of the biggest vehicles that we've modified over the last 30 years is the Dodge Viper that we call the Venom 1000 Viper. And over the years, that kind of evolved into muscle cars, including the Exorcist. And most recently, some of the cool cars that we've been building are actually trucks, including the Velociraptor 6x6 truck. But the car that kind of helped develop the F5 is our Venom GT, and another very cool car that we have. And I'm gonna jump in this and take off. So appreciate it, enjoy the show, thanks.
Obviously, the numbers on this car are absolutely insane, but it's so much more than just that monster V8 in the back. It's been designed from the outset to have a relatively low drag coefficient of about 0.39, so it's possible to hit those speeds of 300 miles an hour and above, but also it's got just enough downforce so you've got some stability at those stratospheric top speeds as well. As a result, the front end of the car is relatively smooth and simple, and you don't have a massive ironing board front splitter or a big silly wing out the back. However, Mr. Hennessey will sell you an optional track pack with both of those things if downforce is more your thing. When we spoke to John Hennessey, I said, is there any active aero on this car? And he said, well, depends how active you are in the hour it takes to bolt both those wings on. Gotta love that.
The wheels are forged aluminium and staggered, so 19 inch at the front, 20 inch at the back. The suspension is fully independent double wishbones with coilover dampers that can be adjusted manually, but not electronically on the move. There is, however, a hydraulic lift system in case you have speed bumps leading up to your mansion. The brakes are Brembo carbon ceramics and the tyres are off-the-shelf Michelin Pilot Sport Cup 2s. And John is confident they're good for 300 miles an hour and beyond.
Now, part of the reason for that is this is an impressively light car. It's got a bespoke carbon fibre tub, it's all carbon fibre panels, its dry weight is just 1,360 kilograms, which is just 30 kilograms heavier than a Ferrari F8 Tributo, and yet it has over 1,000 horsepower more. That's just extraordinary. Let's have a look around the back. Now, clearly this is where the designers have really let their hair down. All right, it's quite a subtle rear spoiler up here, but you've got this massive rear diffuser at the bottom. These tail lights here have got a hole in the middle. That's because they double as vents to extract some of the heat from that massive engine. And then there's this entire mesh panel which goes all the way down here and includes these painted dividers in the middle. That's all one piece, the largest piece of machined carbon fiber you'll find anywhere in the world. The exhausts, there's four of them. They're stainless steel, but more interesting is this coating around the edge, a ceramic heat shield, the same type of ceramic coating you'll find on the inside of a gun. Nice little Texas reference for you there. And while we're here, let's see if we can get this engine cover off and have a look at that beast underneath.
Although based on a classic LS pushrod V8, everything from the dry sump to the cast iron block, titanium intake valves, turbos and engine management system is bespoke, which isn't surprising when you're producing as much grunt as 7.5 Golf GTIs. The gearbox is a 7-speed single clutch semi-auto with paddle shift, and the performance figures are plainly bonkers. 1,817 horsepower at 8,000 RPM, 1,192 pounds-feet of torque at 5,000 RPM, and a power-to-weight ratio of 1,298 horsepower per tonne. Early simulations predict 0-62 miles an hour in 2.6 seconds, 0-124 miles an hour in 4.7 seconds, and 0-250 miles an hour in 15.5 seconds. Just have a little think about that last number. That's more than twice as fast as a Bugatti Chiron, over 7 seconds faster than a Koenigsegg Regera, and the reason why the power available at any given moment will be carefully managed. Otherwise, you'll be spinning your wheels all the way up to 140 miles an hour.
Look at that. Proper doors. Okay, so first things first, yes, there is a bit of the steering wheel missing. This is not an oversight, I'm assured, but entirely intentional because along with the graphics on the instrument display directly in front of you, it's designed to evoke a fighter jet cockpit style feel because, according to John Hennessey, when you're driving at 500 kilometers an hour, you're less of a driver, more of a pilot. I have no way of knowing if that's true or not, but it's a nice line nonetheless. The overall interior design, well, I quite like it. It's a clever piece of design because they're using the big screens to give you the information you need, but still maintaining physical dials and knobs and switches. So if I just take you through it, in the middle of the dash here, we've got this big display screen, which has your Apple CarPlay or Android Auto, because that's all you need these days. Working our way down the center console, you've got these two bullseye vents here, and then you get to this. This is the aircon control, which is quite cool. So you simply swipe up and then you swipe left or right, depending on whether you want to change the fan settings or the temperature settings, and then you've got a physical dial to use there. Neutral, drive, reverse, three simple buttons. These are your electric windows. This is your hydraulic lift. This locks the car, your hazard lights, and a parking brake. Now, because you don't have a boot in the front of this car or in the back, because it's full of engine, they've had to be quite clever about the storage solutions in here. So you've got various cubbies dotted around this big sort of ledge behind you. You could always shove a squidgy bag or some old clothes behind the passenger seat, and then you've got the more clever stuff. So a proper glove box hidden away in the passenger footwell. You've got these slim little holders in the carbon fiber seals here, perfect for carrying your copy of Top Gear magazine, and another little slot down here which is designed specifically for you to pop your phone in so it doesn't go flying around the interior. The seats, yes, carbon fiber shells, but covered in this leather padding. They're about as skeletal as you can get without being torturous because, well, they're not quite plump Chesterfield sofas, these things, but they're comfy enough for long journeys. And then there's little Easter eggs like this, a Texas flag tag on the leather seats. I have to say, I quite like that. Right, returning back to the steering wheel, what can I tell you about this? Well, it's got all the controls that you need. It puts them right in front of you, a bit like a Formula One steering wheel, riffing on that. What I wanted to show you though was the plus minus paddles for the single clutch gearbox, which have the most satisfying rifle bolt action I've ever experienced on a couple of paddles. Top marks for that. In front of you here, you've got indicator switches, you've got dials for your windscreen wipers and your headlights and your big red ignition button down here, which I won't press because you won't be able to hear me. And right in the middle is this Manettino style switch for selecting your driving mode.
There are five driving modes to choose from, but let's focus on track, drag, and F5 VMAX. Track tweaks all the usual ESC, traction control, and braking parameters and dials them up a bit over sport. In drag mode, the exact setup is to be confirmed, but it's all about controlling the power to get the best launch off the line. This is a rear-wheel drive car, remember, so the plan is to raise the nose lift to tip the weight back and improve traction at the rear. And then there's F5 VMAX, the only mode where the full 1800 horsepower will be unleashed. But to unlock it, you'll need to do a day of driver training with Hennessey. They reckon just lobbing owners the keys would be irresponsible.
It is a fairly stunning achievement, this car. I mean, time will tell whether it's actually usable at normal speeds, but it's not just a sledgehammer. There's a level of engineering finesse here that I just didn't expect. Only 24 of them are going to be built starting from next year, costing from £1.9 million. So it's massively rare and wildly expensive, but there's nothing else really like it out there, is there? Which is why we had to have another catch up with Mr. Texas himself to get a deeper understanding of this extraordinary car. Take a look at this.
So, John, with the Venom F5, was there a can you remember the moment when the project was fully conceived, when you pushed that big green button in your head and said, let's do this?
The idea of the F5 came along after the Venom GT had been in existence for a period of time and had reached some level of success and set some speed records back around 2013, but we knew with that car that we wouldn't have the credit that that car deserved until we built our own car. And I had a couple clients kind of share with me, hey, John, you really need to build your own car. But I would say that the idea, that critical go moment was when we had hired a design team and had a budget to begin the exterior design of the car. And we really didn't know what the engineering would look like, but we felt like we could come out with a car that would look like what the F5 was, and that was at the SEMA show in November of 2017.
Inside your head a little bit, why do you want to build the world's fastest road car?
Why do we continue to climb the next highest mountain? I think it's just kind of built into our DNA, and while we like to challenge ourselves and shoot for bigger speed records, when we're able to, once we've had some level of success, we're looking for the next mountain to climb. And at that point in time, again, back in 2013-14, the Venom GT had beaten the Bugatti Chiron Supersport. You know, it had gone 270 miles an hour, and we just kind of felt like, okay, that's great. What's the next mountain to climb? And we kind of felt like the only way we would have a car to achieve the speed goals that we had at the time was 300 miles per hour. And then also, at some point along the journey, we decided, well, for 300 miles per hour, could we get to 500 kilometers per hour, which is a little over 310? That these challenges were what we needed to kind of scratch our creative itch. And so we didn't want a car that had too low of drag, and we didn't want a car with too much drag. We wanted a car that had the proper amount of balance and downforce at 300 plus miles per hour, but it could also still be driven on a B road in the UK. It could still be driven on a circuit, whether it's the Nordschleife or Circuit of the Americas, which is very close to where we're located. So having that overall package and having that overall balance of the car, I think, is something that as the engineering process evolved, we felt like, okay, yeah, we feel good about being able to hit big speed numbers, but we didn't want the F5 to be just a one-hit wonder and go out and go a top speed number, and that's all it's good for.
Drag mode, the track mode, and the VMAX mode, if you just take us through how they work or what they do to the...
And this is really, I think, the most important thing to know about the car is F5 mode is most likely the only mode that will give the driver access to maximum power. So even in drag mode, we're probably not going to unleash all 1,817 horsepower in that mode. Again, it's designed to get them down the quarter mile or standing mile or whatever they're doing.
Object of using all the performance, you're being open about the fact that you do want to do a top speed run. You're going to use the NASA shuttle landing facility. What more can you tell me about it? Is it going to be a totally standard car? Is there different gear ratios, different tires? When are you going to do it? Tell me everything.
Well, that's a great question. So every F5 will be delivered to the customer exactly as to spec for production. So whatever car that we select to go out and do testing with and that we're able to hit a top speed number with, there will be nothing special about that car. So the power delivery, the calibrations, the tires, the settings of the car will be exactly the same that they are for all 24 cars. I think that's very important to note. When we begin testing, we have our own quarter mile drag strip here next to our workshop, so we'll do initial testing there. We'll then move to do some circuit testing, most likely at Circuit of the Americas, which is very close to us. And then we will hopefully soon thereafter end up on the shuttle landing runway, the same place where they used to land the space shuttle down at the Kennedy Space Center at NASA in Florida. That runway from end to end is 3.2 miles long. And we can probably only run upwards of 2 miles under wide open throttle, maybe 2.2 miles, but we'll need that last mile to slow down. What kind of speeds can we hit in that distance? We're certainly not gonna hit the top speed, the absolute top speed of the car. I think it's possible that the car might run in the realm of 300 miles per hour, maybe a little below, maybe a little bit above. But the whole purpose of going to NASA and doing these other tests is not to set records and flex for the world and through the media and through Top Gear. It's really about making our car the best car that it can be and making our car the safest and most enjoyable car for our clients to be able to drive and experience. And so if along that journey we're able to go out and run some sort of a big number, maybe if we can, you know, Koenigsegg is 277.9 miles per hour, two-way average. I think that is still kind of the official, that's the officially regarded two-way average number. And then look, the Bugatti 305.8 miles per hour in one direction, that's a huge number. Can we do that at NASA? I'm not sure that we have enough runway length to do that, because again, if you look at what the guys at Bugatti did at Air Lacine back in September of 19, they hit that 304, and I think that that track is 6 miles long or something in that vicinity. So we're working with half the distance. So you say, okay, John, what about 500K? What about, you know, being the fastest? We'll need to find a public road somewhere. And again, I don't know where we'll do that. Ideally, I'd like to do it here in Texas. That may be a little bit a ways down the road, but I think that we've got a shot at maybe breaking the 300 mile per hour mark first and doing it on that runway. And if we're able to do it, again, it'd be in half the distance that the Bugatti guys had to work with when they ran the Chiron at Air Lacine. We're running an off-the-shelf Michelin Pilot Sport Cup tire, the Cup 2 tire, very similar to what the Koenigsegg guys have run on the Regera RS when they went to 277.9 miles per hour. And where we feel good about the tire and the technology is that, number one, as compared to, say, the Bugatti, our car's very light. And when we go out and do our testing with the car, our engineering team and John Heinrichsi, we will be able to measure the loads on each tire as the car progressively goes faster. And in that process, as we go past 200, 250, and start inching our way towards 300 miles per hour, we will know the load on each corner, we'll know the tire temperature and pressures on each corner. And as we progressively work our way up through that process, we will work very closely with the engineers at Michelin. And if anywhere along the way we don't feel that the car is capable or should go beyond a certain point, we may speed limit the car. And I don't want to do that, we don't intend to do that, but we feel good at this point based on aero, based on the known load ratings per tire, that we can manage the speed and the load per corner. And once we have that data and we feel good about it, we'll keep progressively going faster. At what point do we say, why should we go any faster? I kind of think that if we're able to get up in that 500K realm, if we're able to go 310, 312, and I won't tell you what the aerodynamicists and the engineers tell us that the absolute top speed, the drag limited top speed of the car is, because it's a number well beyond 310, 311 miles per hour. But I kind of feel like at that point, if we're able to do that and nobody else has done that on a two-way average, I kind of feel like, what's the point in going beyond that? Now, I say that now, but we're known for, again, climbing mountains. And if at some point we think, okay, let's go back out and see if we can go faster. If our driver and our team feel like there's a good reason for it, we can do some validations. But again, there's a very logical, methodical process to this, and it's not going out, it's not about going out and trying to, you know, put a video out and grab lots of hype and lots of attention. It's about building an amazing car.
Why are you only going to make 24 of them? Seems like a small number. Is it about exclusivity and justifying the price? Because let's face it, it's a lot of money. How did you come to that number?
Again, I think going back to kind of what I was thinking back in that 2017 timeframe, again, in a world where you have 500 LaFerraris and 375 P1s and 500 Sennas, I wanted to build something that was very, very exclusive and very unique and uniquely American and Texan. And I felt like that was very important. I also felt like, you know, I've got a business that produces, next year may produce 1,000 trucks and SUVs. So F5 is not the only thing that we do here. Although F5 is part of a separate company that we've set up. We're in a separate facility in our building right now that's dedicated towards F5 production. And we are planning on building other cars beyond F5, and we won't talk about that today. But yeah, I think that we've got half of that production is already spoken for. I'm sure once the news gets out and people watch this video, we'll probably sell out the rest of the cars. And look, it might take us the next 3 years to build those cars. So during that time, you'll see kind of what's our next vehicle to follow after the F5. And so we're very comfortable with it. We're not super profitable, but we are profitable at making 24 cars. And again, I think that the F5 is like, at the very inception of this idea, the idea of the F5 began in March of 2013. At that time, I didn't know the name of the car, I didn't know what it was gonna look like, I didn't know who was gonna design it. And I just thought, if we had one target, one bogey for one car that we could try to emulate, that would be the McLaren F1. This is our opportunity to build our Texas version of a McLaren F1. We won't know whether we've hit that target or not for at least 20 plus years, but I feel like it's an important part of the legacy, part of the 30-year history of our company thus far, and I think we wanted to signal to the world a sign of more things to come over the next 30 years.
Is there an electric car in Hennessey's future? It's not very Texan.
Are you some sort of a mind reader? Okay, so electrification has been on everybody's minds for quite a while now, and we are strongly considering doing an electrified car at some point beyond F5. I don't know if that's the next car after F5, but it's something that I think that we may be able to share with you in the next several years. And my only beef with electrification is I think they're too heavy. I'm a believer in simple. So F5, might it be the world's kind of final great Uber hypercar that's only internal combustion powered? I don't know, we'll see. But again, we're either gonna do internal combustion or we're gonna do electrified. At this point, we have no plans to do any kind of a hybridized.
Right, honestly, I'm so excited about this car. Hopefully, we'll be able to jump on a plane sometime soon and come and see you in the US and have a go.
That'd be awesome. And we'd like to come over to the Festival of Speed next summer if we can too. So we'll get connected on a runway or a circuit, either in Europe or in Texas soon, I hope.
All right, well, thanks, John. I really appreciate your time. Thanks for that.
Thank you, Jack. Talk to you soon.